Hello everyone, this is Architect Udaya, Assistant Professor, Periyar Maniyamman Institute of Science and Technology, UNIST Kollam Thanjavur. And today we are going to see in this presentation about the passive strategies to have good daylighting inside a building. So here are a few examples showing how daylighting can efficiently modify the space which we design. So in architecture, to articulate a space, daylighting is very essential. So here we are going to start with few essentials we have already seen, like what is vision, what is light, and etc. First we start from vision. So vision is the most developed of all our senses than hearing, than smelling and then touching. So without vision, we couldn't able to see what we have in front. So vision is the first important senses. Then to have a proper vision, lighting is so important. Electromagnetic radiation, which have 7 types of radiation, which includes radio waves, microwaves, infrared, visible light, X-rays, UV rays and gamma rays. We have this visible light rays, which is a very, very smaller segment of the ER radiation, that is the electromagnetic radiation, which is helping us in viewing everything around. So with this amount of daylighting, we need to take care of few aspects which is going to help us in having a very good lighting inside. So which includes the size and location of openings, the glazing that we are going to use in the opening, the configuration of the room, and the reflective properties of walls, ceilings and other surfaces. If you take the intensity of the daylight that is going to enter inside a space, that actually depends on the height, the location of the openings on the wall, and the distance between the space where you need the daylighting and the opening distances. All this going to influence the amount of daylighting which will enter inside the space. For this, we have few basic principles of daylighting. So for the daylighting, the source is going to be the sun. So the sun reaches its earth surfaces through all the atmospheric layers. So while it is entering through the atmospheric layers, it undergoes lot of scattering, reflection and modulation in the beams that is going to come inside. While it reaches inside, the light is going to get deviated into direct light and diffuse light. So direct light is the light which is received from the sun directly, and diffuse light is the light which is going to get scattered or reflected from the sky, and you will get the light which may be very little or very subtle in nature when you compare to the harsh direct light which is received. So if we take a particular point in a building, it can consist of direct sunlight, diffuse light or skylight. You will have externally reflected light and internally reflected light. Say it is being shown clearly in the picture given below. So you will have the direct sunlight which is entering here inside your space. Then you will have the reflected light, and the reflected light also depends on the ground quality and the nearby surfaces which is there near your opening. So here there is a building and the light getting hits on the building and getting reflected. So the reflecting quality of the building also will be encountered. The availability of light which reaches inside a building at a particular point completely depends upon the plan form, orientation of the building and the size of openings and location of the openings in a building, and the characteristics of the openings like glazings and other internal reflections, everything to be encountered while we calculate the daylight factor. So in a building, in a given point, the ratio of indoor illumination to the corresponding outdoor illumination can be taken as a constant, and this constant ratio is expressed as the indoor illumination at a point divided by the outdoor illumination from the unobstructed hemisphere into 100. That is the percentage ratio which is being considered for the daylight factor. So there are like three components which contributes to the daylight factor, which are the sky component, the externally reflected component, and the internally reflected component. All these three components are added together to attain the daylight factor. If you take sky component, that is the area of clear visible sky from the given point inside your building, the average altitude angle from the given point, and the window size or any opening size, that can be a window or it can be the door openings as well. Its position and the frame, the quality of glass and the material which is going to be used, everything will be calculated for the sky component. Next is the external reflected component, which is the area of external surfaces which are visible from the point considered, and the reflectance of the external surfaces that are around, that can be the ground surface or the nearby building or any other surfaces which is visible from your given point. Then the internal reflected component. This includes the size of the room from where the point of consideration is considered. Then the ratio of the surfaces like walls, roofs, etc. In relation with the opening size, its reflectance quality of the indoor surfaces, etc. So this is the example of what we have seen already. So your DF, daylight factor, depends upon the internal reflectant components, external reflectant component, and the sky component. So sky component is what we get directly from the skylight. External reflectant component is the light which is going to hit on the adjacent building or on the ground and then will be reflected inside. Then you will have the internal reflectant component as well. So everything together will help you in giving the daylight factor. So this is a small example of how to consider the daylight factors, and we are given with a few list of daylight percentages for various typology of buildings. Example for dwellings, schools, offices, hospitals, and libraries. The lighting levels for spaces or activities such as kitchens, laboratories, and the counter areas where you need to concentrate and work, or your skill need lot of lighting to have to do your work efficiently. And if you compare that with the areas, spaces such as circulation spaces or stacking area, which requires a comparatively very little amount of daylighting. So this has to be considered before designing your building. For this, we are given with few daylighting systems which are passive in nature, which will help you in reducing the artificial lighting which you require in a building. So in conventional modes, we have few systems. For an example, we have windows, we have clear stories, skylights, which we use from the historical times. Here I have given image of a church where we can see a clear story window, which is very common in church buildings. And you have a modern clear story for a living area, living cum dining area, where the lighting is being achieved through your clear story. And here you have a window opening from where you have a good amount of daylighting entering inside your building. Then you can have skylights as well, which will help you in bringing in daylight. So apart from these, we have other strategies to bring in daylighting to your building. First is light shelves. Light shelves are nothing but horizontal reflective surfaces which either extend outside your building or it can extend inside your building or both. It will have a reflective coating on top which will help you in reflecting the light inside your building, and that will again diffuse through the through your ceiling, and you will receive your lighting to a deeper area inside your building. So the positive aspects of light shelves is that it will help you in reducing the unwanted sunlight which is entering, which is also called as glare. So these are few examples of how you can use these light shelves. So in the first example, it is being given, the light shelves are given at the external area where it will help you as a shading device to control or cut down the glare, and the reflective coating on top of your device will help you in reflecting the light inside your space. In the second unit, you will have the device installed on external and the internal areas, which is going to help you in diffusing the light and penetrating the helping in penetrating the light entering deeper inside. And in the third example, it has been given in the internal area, which will help you in getting deeper light into your spaces. So this is going to help you in increasing the reflection quality of your internal space, and it will also reduce the amount of sky component which helps in reducing the glare. Then is the atrias and courtyards. Atriums and courtyards are being used from our historical ages. We have multi-story buildings where you will have the central courtyard or atrium spaces which will help you in dragging in the light, daylight. So we have very good examples of residence buildings like Chettinad houses, where you can see a very huge courtyards which will help you in bringing in the daylight. And you have examples seen in highly deserted area where the lighting and ventilation will be achieved through your courtyards. So here, along with the top lighting and side lighting, we can enhance these kind of strategies and increase the amount of daylighting which is occurred inside. So here you can install sun catches which can help you in getting and reflecting back these amount of sunlight into deeper internal spaces or the spaces which is adjacent to your main atrium or courtyard spaces. So William M.C. Lamb have differentiated the difference between atrium and a litrium. So M.C. Lamb is a person who have written on perception and lighting as form givers for architecture, and he is being called as the pioneer in architectural lighting as well. So what he says is you will have a clear difference between atrium and litrium. Atrium, when the height of the building is going to be higher, you will have the narrower top area and a wide bottom area, which is given here. You will have the narrow top area where you will get the lighting, and your bottommost floor area will be widened. Where in litrium, the width of the topmost area will be wide, and when you go down, it can narrow down to your bottommost floor. And litrium will help you in getting more light efficiently inside your building. Again, this is an example of Hong Kong National Bank, which was done by Norman Foster. Here, what they have done is they have reflective mirrors hanging on the topmost level from the ceiling at different angles. So these angular mirrors will help you in reflecting the sunlight inside a building, and that will reflect till the bottommost floor. This building also This particular building comprises of three different blocks, which varies from 29 floors to 44 floors. So the particular lighting system which has been adopted helped in lighting till the bottommost floor or the lobby area of every other floors. So next, we are going to see about sun catches. These are again vertical light reflector systems which can be installed in the clear story areas, which will help in capturing the sunlight and drawing down it to your interior spaces. These are kind of like the wind catches. So wind catches help you in capturing the wind, and it will allow it to flow inside to the necessary spaces. Likewise, sun catches will also help you in capturing the sun and reflecting down to your required areas. So these sun catches are not so efficient in south facing openings, because already south facing openings will be kind of harsh. So these can be used to lit the western and eastern sides, where you will have generally a very poor lighting condition. These are few examples of these kind of sun catches. These sun catches will be entering through your atria or courtyard areas, and you will have baffles or a luo kind of system which will help in reflecting the sun's rays. So eastern and western side will have the lowest angle, so these kind of system will help you in reflecting back the lowest angle sunlight to your deeper interior spaces. Again, these atrias and courtyards can have optical systems to improve the lighting. And here again are few sun catching kind of systems which are installed in your rooftops like atriums and courtyards. So what will happen is the harsh sunlight can be reduced, and atriums will help you in lighting the interior spaces. So whatever the space which you have immediately next to your courtyard or atrium spaces can be reflected by using your optical systems installed in your atriums and courtyards. So that is what we are going to see. So these optical systems will have a collection of optical fibers which will be installed in your roofs or atrium areas, that will help you in transmitting the light to your deeper interior spaces. The other kind is the light pipe or the light wells. So what happens here is, again, the light will be captured at the topmost level and it will be transmitted to the lower area. These systems are possible in urban areas where you will have lot of land scarcity and you need to go for high-rise buildings. When you go for high-rise buildings, it is not possible to lit all your individual spaces properly or efficiently. So these systems will help you in dragging down the daylighting and will give back to individual spaces, at least to a good extent. So here in these light bulb, you will have the topmost dome, and you will have a bottommost dome kind of area. And in between, you will have a aluminium pipe which is running through, which is connecting the exterior and the interior areas. So these topmost dome areas will be of acrylic domes, which will be translucent, and that will capture the sunlight, and it will be transmitted through aluminium pipes. And at times these pipes will be lined with silver coating. Obviously, aluminium and silver will have very good reflection quality. So these reflection quality will enhance the amount of light that is being transmitted to the individual spaces. So this is one good example of these kind of light shafts which is used by Renzo Piano in High Museum in Atlanta, Georgia. So here these are very smaller portions of these light shelves or light pipes. Here these areas will capture the sunlight which is given here. So these capture the sunlight and it will deviate it to the correct position. And here since it is a museum, you have lot of displays, and they have tried to lit all these displays using these kind of smaller segments of light shafts. So these light shafts will have a lot of varied angles to capture, and it will kind of reflect inside of the pipes, and it will be transmitted. So you can have lenses installed at the topmost area, which will help you in reflecting at every interval. So these kind of systems can be installed in an apartment or some high-rise building, where you can have various levels, and every other level you can have a reflection lens. So from that particular level, that can lead to that particular floor area. Then you can have prismatic pipes. So again, it will reflect back in the interior and will let down. So these are kind of various type of systems. You have fiber optics, again you have light rods, and you will have mirrored light pipes as well. So these kind of system will kind of reduce the energy consumed to lit your interior spaces, and on the other hand, you will reduce the amount of non-renewable energy that is being used to lit every other space. So this is the detailed concept of the light well. So you have the light well where you will have the light pipe which is installed. You will have the topmost area from where it get reflected, and the sun catcher kind of system where the sun's rays will be captured, and it will be through into your individual spaces or transported to your individual spaces. Again, these are few variations of using these kind of light shafts or light wells. This is a narrow building which is an atrium. Through these atriums, this is litting the interior spaces, whereas this is a litrium. So where your topmost area is wider, and while it is going down, it is getting narrower, and the same kind of system is being used in litriums as well. Then you have tubular daylighting systems. So these kind of tubular daylighting system is similar to your light shafts or light wells, but this is going to be in a smaller scale. So here also you will have the light capturing area, a transporter, and a distributor point. So the distributor will diffuse the light and will help you in getting the light inside. So this particular system was invented by Solar Tube International in the year 1993, and they have a lot of variations in these systems. So here which is given is a very smaller segment. So this is the detail of the particular system which has been invented, and you have a lot of variations which has been given here. So you have a variation in the dome that you have the topmost area, then you have a different kind of piping systems. So these kind of piping systems can be given on the topmost area, or it can be given using a very long or lengthier pipe which is going to transport the light. So the one main condition here that has to be taken care is the reflectance quality of the particular tube that is going to transport the light from the dome or the exterior area or the capture zone. This is the capture zone. So the quality of the capture zone also has to be taken care. It should not get dusty, or it should not get damaged due to any other weather condition. So it should have a proper clear surface, transparent surface, so that it can capture good amount of sunlight. And the transportation zone or the transport zone, which should have a proper reflectance quality. Then you should have a delivery zone. The delivery zones should diffuse the light, but it should not glare at the same time. So again, lot of mirrors and lenses are being used to direct the light into your interior spaces. You can have lot of reflectors or tracking devices which can be kept on your roof areas or the areas where you can have good lighting. And then these mirror or lenses can direct the light to the area where you need good lighting. So this will catch the low angle sunlight during the sunrise and sunset timing, or even during the winter timing, and it will help you in diverting the light to the required area. So this system is called as the Himavari system. Himavari means sunflower. Just like sunflower, this particular system have a sunlighting positioning sensor. So this particular sensor will help the particular lens, the group of lenses, to just track the sun's position and move along with the sun's position. So here you will have 12 numbers to 198 lenses. So the smallest system will have 12 lenses, and the maximum largest Himavari system will have 198 lenses. So these lenses are honeycomb typology of lens, so which is formed in a honeycomb type using Fresnel lenses, which will focus the sunlight into a quartz glass optical fiber. So these fibers will carry on the light to the deeper areas. So this is the setup of that particular system. So here you have so many number of Himavari lenses installed together. This can be installed in an individual manner as well. So this is a comparison between the Himavari system installed in a small scale residential area and a large scale office area. So while we are comparing, this states that if you have 6 number of fiber cables, which is a 40 meter length, it can lit the indoor area, which is equal to an incandescent lamp, which is of 75 watt. So this is the comparison given for this particular Himavari system. So this can be installed anywhere where you will get a very good lighting. So next is laser cut light deflecting panels. These are panels which is of 2 mm acrylic sheet, which is of 2 mm acrylic sheet. So this is the type of sheet which is being used. Here you will have individual lower kind of system. These systems will deflect back or reflect the light to the interior spaces. This will help you in penetrating the light, reflecting the light to penetrate deeper inside your individual spaces and help you in reducing the glare, because the harsh light, when it tries to enter, this will again reflect back to the sky or the outdoor area itself. So this is how it works. It will enter inside and the inner layer will deflect the light to the required area. So this can be, that particular system can be installed in windows as well as in the skylights or the roof areas as well. Next is the refractive device. In these refractive device, this is going to be a single solid section of dielectric method. You will have a curved base and you have a V-shaped trough, which is being given here. So this will reflect the light and let light your interior space. This will again reduce the amount of glare that can be entering into your system. So again, this is it. So these also can be installed in your windows. So that's all on the daylighting passive strategies. The basic information has been gathered from the MNRE resource and with the additional few websites. Thank you.